Hello and welcome to Business on the Wire with me, Mitali Mukherjee. We're talking today about a journey that began in 2014 or perhaps earlier and is a large part of the political fabric that we live in at this point. Modi's India is a book that's been authored by renowned political scientist, Professor Christophe Jaffrelot, and the book travels the arc since 2014 of India's Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his journey into what seems or has been often described as a persona that he has built at this point. Of course, much of it has been structured around very, very sharp vocabulary, directed attacks at opponents, especially the Congress's Gandhi family, and a messaging that seems to reach out directly to the masses, bypassing other structures like the media or any other structures that may have existed in the past. There is another facet to the journey since 2014. Professor Jaffrelot believes this is a new kind of democracy that India is living through, an ethnic democracy. To explain it better, he equates this as a system where the majoritarian community with the nation is identified more as a Hindu nation, and it relegates other communities such as Muslims and Christians to almost second-class status. Some of this is fed and aggravated by vigilante groups, and this kind of harassment also extends to groups like not-for-profits, to civil society members, as the case has been over the last couple of years. Joining me now to talk about the facets of this book, what it points to for India's future, and whether this is a system of politics and democracy that looks like it's here to stay, is the author himself, Professor Jaffrelot. Thank you, Professor Jaffrelot, for joining me and speaking with me about your book. I want to start with a little bit of where we are now. If you look back at 2014, particularly with the populist image that you have carved out in your book, would you say we have traveled much farther down the road, or do you think there have been some changes since then?
Well, there have been some changes, and it's the usual pattern, because most of populists, national populists, when they exert power, necessarily change their attitude. There are some things which remain the same, and the way to relate to the people by and large remain the same. So, for instance, Man Ki Baat was something that simply routinized a way to relate to the people that was already there during the 2014 election campaign, for instance. But at least two developments were inherent in the exercise of power, the way a populist exerts power, a national populist exerts power, implies two things. One, a form of ethnicization of democracy, because when you represent a fraction of the people, the majority, but a fraction of the people as a national populist, you also transform minorities into second-class citizens almost mechanically, almost automatically. So from national populism to ethnic democracy, there is a direct route. And we saw this in so many other countries, including Orban's Hungary, Netanyahu's Israel, Erdogan's Turkey. And secondly, the other transformation that is also rather mechanical is the authoritarian turn, because the populist leader claims that because of the popular mandate that he has received from the people, his legitimacy prevails over institutions, the parliament, the bureaucracy, even the judiciary can't compete. You know, this is, by the way, what Arun Jaitley said when they tried to reform the judiciary, the way judges were appointed immediately after the 2014 elections. He said, we will not bow to the tyranny of the unelected. No, the unelected can't compete with the elected because he is the people. So these two trajectories from 2014 were quite classic, very similar to the patterns we find in other countries. I have mentioned many. We could also mention Bolsonaro's Brazil. Yeah.
I want to address both those important blocks, but I also want to stay with the here and now for a minute, Professor. In the entire course of the Modi regime, what is being seen as a watershed moment is a protest that started at the end of 2020 and finally came to some kind of closure a few weeks back when the Prime Minister had to step up and say, I'm repealing the farm laws. I'm not going to go ahead with them. In fact, as we speak today, they were repealed in Parliament. Would you say that has impacted or hit this strongman image? Because it met with a great deal of criticism from his supporters. They felt quite cheated and let down by this decision and this walk back that the Prime Minister had to take.
We'll see. We'll see whether it is a turning point or not. It's too early to say. And, you know, we have already seen that the predictions people had made vis-a-vis the loss of popularity of Narendra Modi were wrong. You know, so many people anticipated that the second wave of COVID would result in loss of popularity. You know, charismatic leaders are above accountability. And my previous book that I co-authored with Pratinav Anil on the emergency had already shown that Indira Gandhi could be re-elected after the emergency, after the atrocities of the emergency, because she was charismatic and she was above accountability. So we'll see. We'll see whether the Indudva repertoire is eroded, whether Modidva is also losing some of its appeal because of socio-economic consideration, because of social issues like the farmers' issues, or not. And the UP elections will be an interesting test in that regard, but they will not be the test. The test will be 2024.
That's just the question I was coming to, actually. You know, in your book, you also talk about how the Prime Minister, in terms of his image, has the ability to straddle this traditional persona versus the modernity. He's very easy with social media. He seems to be very benevolent towards technology and tech-driven change. But he's also seen conducting a lot of religious ceremonies. In the prism of these upcoming UP elections, how do you think he's going to mold that? And how much more accentuated do you think that whole narrative of an ethnic democracy is going to get, the strong Hindutva state?
Well, he is very cautious always not to appear as communal. So it will never be an anti-Muslim discourse from Modi's side. You may have pro-Indudva symbols, of course, Ayodhya, maybe other places, but I don't see this kind of strategy in the coming elections. I suppose he'll try to address the issues which are at the back of the mind of everybody, that is poverty alleviation. And he's very good at that in terms of discourse this time, not so much in terms of practices, but you must remember the 2017 election campaign when he toured Uttar Pradesh few weeks after demonetization. The economy was on its knees. The poor were impoverished, and he was successful. He was very successful. It was a very successful election campaign because he could appear as a fakir, as he said in Moradabad. You know, the Moradabad speech is an amazing one. It's available on the net. It's easy to see how the Modi magic could work. He said, "I have demonetized for you, against the rich, against corruption," and it worked. People clapped. After that, you've had the Ujjwal Yojana, the Janda Yojana. Swachh Bharat was also used. The 2019 elections were interesting in that sense that programs, yojanas, which were not resulting in any transfer, any substantial transfer of funds, could be seen as pro-poor anyway, because of the symbols, because of what I call in the book, the politics of dignity. It's a sign of respect by the leader to give latrines, to give gas cylinders, to give a plastic card for an account, for a bank account on which there is no money, but there is a plastic card. There is this feeling that the leader is taking care of me. This is what my colleague Nilanjan Siyakar calls Vishwas politics, trust in the leader among the poor people. Maybe one of the main, arguments he will try to cash in on, because it worked in the past. And Uttar Pradesh is in a very bad shape in terms, in socioeconomic terms. So probably that will be the main strategy. And there'll be another one, the usual caste equation. Never forget that BJP, in spite of all the discourses against caste politics, against caste dividing society, has become a very great expert at playing caste cards. So what we will probably see is an attempt again at marginalizing the dominant Dalit groups, the Jatavs, the dominant OBC groups, the Yadavs, to make sure that the non-Jatav Dalits, those who resent the Jatav's domination, the way the Jatavs have cornered reservations, for instance, are represented among the candidates of BJP and therefore among the voters of BJP. And that's what had happened in the past. The BJP was very good at getting the vote of Balmiki, Skatiks, all Dalit groups, which are inclined towards Sanskritization, but which are even more happy to support BJP against BSP, against the Jatavs, divides and rule. That will be the subtext of this election again.
I completely agree with you in terms of the fact that there have been almost crucial blows to leadership, whether it was demonetization or the migration crisis during COVID or the following COVID wave where people were struggling for basic medical support. And yet the leader emerged as someone who was concerned and apologetic and not really responsible for what happened. But the one thing that has changed in the last few months, Professor, is the fact that inflation is now really pinching people hard at a very personal level, food inflation, fuel inflation. Do you believe that could be a factor in terms of unifying the opposition, at least in the limited space of Uttar Pradesh before we talk about 2024? Do you think that could be a factor?
Yeah, no, certainly. And you make a distinction that is very important. This is a state election. It's not a national election. And even with Narendra Modi canvassing for BJP in state elections more than any other prime ministers in the past, for sure, BJP is not winning any state election for 5 years. You know, the last state election BJP won was Uttar Pradesh, 2017. So certainly, socioeconomic factors like inflation will be more important this time. And maybe next time, you know, this is the big question. When will identity politics cease making the agenda hostile or, I would say, immune to socioeconomic issues? When will this happen? When will the poverty alleviation programs, when will inequality issues come back as dominant arguments and factors? Maybe now, maybe the farmers' movement has been the turning point, but we will see. We'll have to wait for election results to see what has happened, if anything.
Is it your sense, though, that for 2024, the dominant theme will remain the birth of this ethnic democracy and moving closer and closer towards that, or at least promising that carrot to the voters?
again, it's very early. It's too early to say. What is for sure is that the trend is making inequality more and more palpable. The economic crisis is now a reality nobody can ignore. So inevitably, that will have to be taken care of by the government. The last reshuffle of the Modi government was a very interesting one. Narendra Modi appointed ministers coming in larger numbers from Dalits, from OBCs, from tribals, showing that he had realized that these kind of issues had a new reality and he had to take care in, to take this into account. He may make the same kind of transformation, or he may also innovate, adapt. In that sense, what we've seen, maybe this is another transformation, is Narendra Modi is a political animal who adjusts to circumstances. And when he needs to withdraw farmers' laws, it takes time. It takes a lot of times, but he does it at the end, instead of committing suicide, instead of committing political suicide, which is new in some ways. You know, when he was chief minister in Gujarat in 2003, he alienated Bharatiya Kisan Sangh, he alienated the Sangh Parivar at large, by the way, by the way he dealt with the peasants. He has clearly learned some lessons from this kind of experiences, and now he adapts, he adjusts. So maybe he will in 2024 be again another man. He has reinvented himself at least twice over the last few years, and the new look he has adopted, the beard he has grown, is a symbol of this capacity to try to reinvent himself. No prime minister, I mean, no statesman I know of has changed their look so dramatically during their political career. It's not unimportant. It's a symbol of this capacity to adjust, to retain power. Because at the end of the day, what matters? What matters the most? To stay in office.
My question was actually more in terms of how you think the voter is thinking now, Professor Jaffrelot, because you had a series of conversations while curating this book. There's a book, not similar, but along the same lines, that Dr. Tharoor has written. And, Pratap Bhanu Mehta commented on that book saying, let's name the problem for what it is. Deep-seated prejudice against Muslims. No amount of tradition can solve that angst. We need political, not metaphysical solutions. Do you believe that at the crux of it, this remains the overarching point for a voter? This is what they're going to vote on even in 2024.
Well, that is certainly something that will remain. This prejudice, this majoritarian prejudice. But an overarching prejudice can be replaced by another overarching prejudice. No. Mandal versus Mandir, or Mandir versus Mandal, was precisely what they tried to create, to antidote to the Mandal politics, caste-based politics. Caste-based politics can come back. And it's not because you have this deep-rooted prejudice vis-a-vis minorities that another line of cleavage cannot be resurrected. This is certainly the most likely way out for those who try to get rid of Hindutva as the dominant discourse. And this is certainly one of the reasons why you have seen this reshuffle in the last 2 months. Not only the Modi government has been transformed, but the UP government has been transformed, playing the caste card again. So if BJP plays the caste card, it's certainly that caste is back to some extent. because when socioeconomic issues come back in India, it's mostly via the caste idiom. So possibly we will see this new development before 2014 and a new plebeian BJP.
There's another track that you take on, which has been quite visible over the last few years, Professor, which is how many institutions have either been circumvented or completely taken over to the benefit of the ruling establishment. Either the media and not-for-profits have been completely sidelined, or statutory organizations like the Enforcement Directorate or parts of the judiciary have been taken over. Have you seen parallels of this across the other countries and leaders that you were speaking of? And how bad does it
get? This is the standard practices. When a national takes over, he uses his charisma, his power, to concentrate authority in his hands and for prevailing over the existing institutions. So one of the first things Viktor Orban has done in Hungary, and one of the first things Kaczynski has done in Poland, was also to change the way judges were appointed. In India, they could not do it officially because the Supreme Court said, no, we will retain the collegium system, except that de facto, the collegium system has been eroded. Because de facto, many judges, and in the book I give the full list, has just not been reconfirmed. So they are selected by the collegium, but they are not confirmed by the government. It's one of the ways, it's one of the many ways in which you can somewhat reduce the power, the authority of the judiciary. There are many others, including post-retirement jobs, including ways to blackmail judges because there is a file on everybody and no judge is sent. And of course, there is a kind of politicization of the judiciary that is now rather obvious in terms at least of ideologization. That's for the judiciary. What we see in other countries like Erdogan's Turkey is the appointment of bureaucrats at the helm of key institutions. Bureaucrats who are close to the executive. Either you do not replace bureaucrats when they retire, and it's very difficult to make the Central Information Commission work and the RTI to be implemented, RTI Act, if there is no commissioner. So either you keep post vacant or you appoint friends at the helm of CBI, at the helm of NIA, at the helm of Election Commission. Now, when we see Mr. Ashok Lavasa not becoming chief election commissioner, whereas he was supposed to be, there is a strong suspicion that other bureaucrats, more pliable probably, had been selected in its stead. So yes, this is what we saw in Turkey. This is what we saw in so many places. One institution that has not been directly touched so far, in contrast to Bolsonaro's Brazil, for instance, is the army. And for me, this is one of the areas of interest that we do not study sufficiently, because that may be a key institution at the end of the day. And it's very difficult, very difficult to have any idea of what kind of politicization, if any, we see there. But the others, I think the list is complete. This is a classic erosion of checks and balances, a classic erosion of alternative power centers, and concentration of power at the expense of these institutions, at the expense of federalism as well. You know, there is something probably that needs to be also studied more, is the way power has been centralized at the expense of state governments. When you can implement demonetization without consulting chief ministers, when you can impose the first lockdown without consulting the chief ministers, no, you are at cross purpose with what cooperative federalism is about. But it's interesting to see that many state governments do resist. And it's one of the probably most resilient power center, the states.
Let me talk for a bit about the importance of the RSS in the government and governance. You write in your book, within the RSS, appetite for political power was traditionally frowned upon as the organization preferred to work on changing society from within. At least two reasons can explain this new attention that's turned to the state. First, they could expand even more rapidly if they enjoyed state protection. Second, they could envisage using the state apparatus to accelerate reforms that they felt very strongly about. Do you think that has really come to form and shape in the last year? And what would you expect to see from that particular influence in the years to come, especially in the run-up to 2024?
Well, I'd like to flesh out the citation you've just made, because indeed, it's very important to keep in mind that historically, RSS is not state power oriented. And the capture of the state, the conquest of the state, is not a priority, has not been a priority for many, many decades. The priority is to develop the Sangpa River, to develop the Shaka network, and to transform society. Society is the priority, not the state. And there is a lot of suspicion vis-a-vis the capacity of the state to transform society. Society can be transformed by the RSS itself at the grassroots level, not so much in a top-down kind of mechanism. That, I think, has continued to prevail. But as I said, going by your quote, the RSS has certainly found very useful to be helped by the state in some of its areas of interest. One, to discipline society, to transform society, to have vigilante groups which are protected by the police, or sometimes even working, joining hands with the police. That's certainly very useful. You don't have anybody interfering with the way you deal with law of jihad, the way you deal with land jihad, the way you deal with cow protection, the day you deal with conversions, you know, because this is what is important. This is priorities. And if you can do that as vigilante groups like Batrang Dal without police interfering with your work, it's very important. Secondly, yes, there are some domains which are priorities for the RSS and that the state can promote. Education. Education is, of course, one of the priorities. To rewrite the history textbooks, to teach in the classroom what is taught on the Shaka, the history of India, the way they see it. You know, Aryan invasions never took place. Muslim invasions were, of course, bloody ones, and you erase completely the role of the Sufi saints in the Islamization of India. You erase completely civilization that emerged from the Islamization of some sectors of the Indian culture, including architecture or cuisine of arts. And last but not least, of course, you downplay the role of freedom fighters, including Nehru, and promote the role of Sangh Parivar leaders. This is exactly what has happened in Pakistan under Zia, and even before, in fact. So much so, the history students learned in the classroom in Pakistan had to be completely, undone when students went abroad. And I have experienced this many times, the absence of real knowledge of the past, you know, the belief in lies. To believe in his own lies is certainly one of the strategies of the hyper-nationalist authoritarian leaders, because then there's no truth left. It's the best route to backwardness, by the way, the best route to obscurantism, and it's at the opposite. This is in the opposite direction to what science and scientists are supposed to give to a country.
The one thing that has certainly changed since 2014, Professor, is global perception of the leader. We started out with a lot of, razzmatazz, and has now come down to quite a bit of concern. Many of the issues that you highlighted have been raised at global platforms, but it's tricky because of how India is being seen as a counterbalancing force to China. How do you think global pressures will move in the years to come? Are they going to generally just step around the human rights issues or other concerns for India, or do you think it's going to come down harder on the leader in terms of global criticism?
Well, it depends where you look at, because certainly Western governments, most of the Western governments, consider that they need India vis-a-vis China, as you said, to such an extent that their Indo-Pacific strategies are priorities. And in these priorities, India plays a very, very important role. It's very true for the US, for AUKUS countries at large, for France, certainly. There are others. There are other governments, probably the new German government. There are other power centers, including the American Congress, including the European Parliament, including the UN, at least some sections of the UN, where these issues will be highlighted. But the fear of China is such, and the need for India in this coalition making that the West has initiated, Western countries at least, that I don't think human rights can be a bone of contention. I hardly see this as a big issue. You have a greater evil. You know, you must remember what happened in the 80s when, for fighting the Soviets in Afghanistan, the US invested in Pakistan, my Pakistan, right or wrong. And for 11 years, I mean the Zia years, we saw a support from Washington for many years, even when the suspicion vis-a-vis nuclear, proliferation were becoming very strong. You know, for 5 years at least, Ronald Reagan said, no, Pakistan is not proliferating, when he knew perfectly well that it was, because the greater evil was USSR. It's very difficult for the Americans in particular to have two objectives at the same time. They have one objective at the same time. It used to be Islamism, now it's China. So everything for countering China, and the rest is minor issues.
Last question to you, Professor Jaffrelot. you know, moving away from the global stage to what's happening here at the central level of politics, there is a level of frustration about the fact that the opposition seems in flux. There seems to be no viable alternative at this point. And as an extension of that question, there is, you know, a minority in the country that believes when the government changes, we will pivot back to what we were. We will no longer be the ethnic democracy that you describe. What do you read as the situation right now for the opposition? And do you believe that to be the outcome, or do you think too much has changed in the fabric of how this country ticks?
Well, there are two questions indeed there. One about the opposition. First of all, the election competition is not a level playing field anymore. And we have to factor that in the first place. When the BJP can spend $3.6 billion like in 2019, the party is spending more than all its competitors. And when you look at the press coverage, the media coverage during the election campaign, you also realize that this is not a level playing field. So the opposition is weak because of its own weaknesses, but it's also weak for many other reasons. And I think this is something we need to factor in. Now, yes, it's weak because of its divisions. Again, it's interesting to compare. It took 15 years for opponents to Erdogan to join hands and win Istanbul elections twice, for instance. It took 15 years to opponents to Netanyahu for joining hands and finally dislodge Netanyahu from power. Well, it may take 15 years for the Indian opposition to realize that it's a survival issue. Maybe it will be too late. It's never too late, but it takes time. But you do not need necessarily a strong opposition for an alternation in power. Think about 1977. In 1977, nobody knew who would be the prime minister. So it was a vote against, not a vote for. Sometimes the vote against is as strong as the vote for. Now, if there is a change of guard, what a difference will that make? Again, we don't know till we see it. The point of no return has not been reached, I think. But to return to the statu quo ante is certainly difficult. Post-Trump America shows that national populists destabilize democracies, polarize democracies in a rather sustainable manner. Also because when they return to the opposition or when they are in the opposition, they are constantly making the life of the new government difficult. And it will probably take quite some time for stabilizing democracy again if there is an alternation in power. It's not impossible. It's never impossible, of course. But I think, again, you see, we learn from others. And what we learn from others show that we might have entered a new era. You know, the national populists across the globe are creating new regimes, and these new regimes are rather sustainable, especially in the context of vulnerability vis-a-vis dominant foreign countries. The fear of the the fear of China will also help national populists to continue to dominate at least the discourse of these new regimes. But I repeat, that it doesn't mean that the point of no return has been reached, and there is of course a lot of hope in many, many places across the globe for the India we knew to be back. And I'm sure you feel the same in the media in particular.
What do we have if we don't have hope, Professor? It's been a sobering read and it's been a sobering conversation, but I always appreciate your insight and time. Thank you so much for speaking with me and for discussing your very excellent book with me. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity.
Get a sneak peek of exclusive content before everyone else, for channel members only. Memberships start at ₹89. Hit the join button below.